Get started here. Today, such a delight. We have Origen of Alexandria, and the other day I started to read the passage in the book, and I got about halfway through, and I stopped, and I thought, oh boy, we got the wrong guy reading this book. And I called up Father Justin, and I said, it's your turn. Father Justin has forgotten more than I ever learned about Origen of Alexandria. And one of the things I said to him this morning was, lift up the book and show him how fat it is. You know, just so you can see the writings of an early theologian here. So let us pray as we begin. Lord, we give you thanks for this day, for the sun that rises and the Son of God that rises up in our hearts. And we give you thanks for the communion of saints, of which one is Origen of Alexandria. And we give you thanks for our communion and our small sainthood. And we ask that you light us on the same fire that Origen felt, so that together we might bring glory to you, and that we might bring glory to you in our heads and in our hearts and in our souls and in our hands, and that we might do it on a sunny day on the fifth Sunday of Lent. Amen. Okay, here comes the man with the brains.
That's a big stretch. Just a second while I get doped up. So Origen. Origen is one of my favorite theologians, but he is trippy as anything. Those of you guys who had a chance to read the book will see that Origen, for somebody who's numbered among the early church fathers, he holds a variety of very interesting beliefs. First of all, I want to walk you through his biography, just the kind of key points. This is not exhaustive by any means, but it's just to give you a sense of how wild and tumultuous Origen's life was. These were not the days that we currently live in when, you know, academic theologians enjoy tenure track positions and they kind of sit there and they read their books and they go to pray and then they come back and, you know, nobody gets in too big a fuss about this, that, or the other. This is a rather tumultuous time for Christians and for theologians in general. Persecutions in the Roman Empire, as we've been speaking about, were sporadic. It depended on the emperor, depending on the particular time in which one lived. But Origen was affected by a persecution very early on in his life. His father was persecuted. Legend has it that Origen was one of the reasons why his father was persecuted. Why he was martyred, basically just because Origen, even as a young child, the story goes, encouraged his father to take a stand for Jesus, not to renege on any of his beliefs or that sort of a thing. This would be something that Origen would go on to do, not only for his father, supposedly, but also for his students, and eventually he would die a martyr's death. A little bit more about that in a minute. So I mentioned Origen's students. Bishop Demetrius of Alexandria, okay, Alexandria in Egypt, that's where Origen is from. The bishop there was so impressed with Origen, he was a kind of prodigy, he was so impressed with Origen, even as a young man, that he appointed him to teach at the catechetical school, which had been run by Clement of Alexandria, one of the apostolic fathers, one of the very earliest church theologians who gets taught today. Origen enjoyed so much success that this many kind of went on these sort of speaking tours, we might call them, of the empire, going around to various churches. His travels eventually took him all the way from Alexandria to Caesarea in Palestine. And there Origen got in trouble because he was just so good. He impressed the people in Caesarea so much that they ended up ordaining him as a priest. And this, of course, made his bishop back in Alexandria rather angry. We don't know exactly why Demetrius reacted the way that he did. Perhaps it was because he felt that Origen and the bishops of Jerusalem and Caesarea were kind of flaunting their authority, and in some sense not obeying him or not respecting his leadership and his guidance of Origen. Or it could have been because Demetrius was simply envious of Origen and the success that he enjoyed. In any case, that's not a story that's that's foreign to the church today. Intrigue and episcopal envy of one sort or other, fights between bishops, that kind of thing. Anyway, more about that in the small groups, perhaps, and not for the recording. Anyway, so Demetrius gets offended. Origen has to basically spend the rest of his life in Caesarea, takes refuge there. Eventually, he suffers persecution by the Emperor Decius, which began in the year 250. Origen would subsequently be released, but his body was already so weak from what it had undergone during the persecution that he died later on, sometime around 253, 254. So he was not killed during the persecution, but rather he suffered, what he suffered seemed to have taken such a toll on his life that the church has retrospectively said he died a death worthy of a martyr. Let's put it that way. So there's already a lot of episcopal intrigue, lots of infighting and that sort of thing surrounding Origen's life of teaching and ministry. But his theology itself was rather, as I said, controversial. It was condemned at the Second Ecumenical Council of Constantinople in 553 in the 6th century. Origenism became a kind of a pejorative term, and the church has regarded his theology with a great deal of suspicion ever since then. The thought is always that, well, Origen is just a little too over the edge from an Orthodox standpoint. What's so odd about this is that Origen, as we now know, was really an agenda setter for the future of theology. Theology as we get it really depends quite heavily on Origen's accomplishment. Origen was a genius, okay? Obviously, Bishop Demetrius recognized this, but other people did too. Stories have it that the great Greek philosopher Porphyry said that Origen had mastered Plato as much as any of the Greek philosophers. Some of the secondary literature on Origen names Origen alongside the Greek philosopher Plotinus as founders of Neoplatonism. Origen was quite simply very good at what he did. And what Origen did was he speculated. Okay? So Origen is sometimes known as our first systematic theologian. And this is the first systematic theology. Okay, it's rather thick. It's a book called On First Principles. Unfortunately, we no longer have On First Principles as Origen himself wrote it. Because of the suspicions surrounding Origen's work and its later condemnation at the Second Council of Constantinople, what we have today is a Latin translation produced by one of Origen's apologists named Rufinus. You remember that that Chuck Robertson in his book says that there were really a whole bunch of people who were standing up for Origen. One of those was the church father Jerome initially, and Jerome eventually turns his back on Origen and begins to write critiques of him. Rufinus, however, was always in Origen's corner, and so we owe it to Rufinus that we have any copy of On First Principles at all. The question, though, surrounding the text is, to what extent is it actually what Origen wrote? Or does it reflect some later theological consensus? Is Rufinus, changing what Origen had originally written in order to make him appear more orthodox than he is? This current scholarly consensus on this is still in process. People still debate the extent to which we can really trust Rufinus's Latin translation. A couple of decades ago, we were very, very, very suspicious of it and basically thought that Rufinus had changed a lot of things and made them the opposite of what Origen had originally said. But more recently, appraisal of Rufinus's translation has become more positive. So I was basically taught that you can read On First Principles in this version, and it basically be what Origen thought. But there is some, there's some debate about how reliable the text is, just so you know. And debate rages particularly about portions of the text that seem to reflect his most contentious and controversial beliefs. The only way to talk about Origen is just to tell you the story of his theology. So that's what I'm going to do. Origen, like I said, is a systematic theologian. What that means is he starts out his book with a kind of list of things he thinks are uncontroversial. He thinks they're just reflected in the scriptures. Things like, God is revealed to us in three characters. One called the Father, one called the Son, one called the Holy Spirit. God does this, God does this, God does this, God does this. You start out with that kind of list of Christian beliefs. These include the ideas that God is all-powerful, all-good, and that God is just. The task of a theologian, then, as Origen understands it, is to figure out how all those things, which he thinks are uncontroversial, they're revealed to us in the Scriptures, can all be true at once. Primarily, Origen's motivated by a theodicy problem. You guys know the word theodicy from Leibniz or his send-up by Voltaire in Candide. Okay, theodicy is a justification of the ways of God to human beings. It's an answer to the problem of evil. If God is good and all-powerful and just, why do bad things happen to good people? That would seem to not be just. It would also seem that if God created a world like this, then God would not be good. You could say that, well, maybe God doesn't have the power to ensure that bad things never happen to good people, but in that case, you would have said that God is not omnipotent. And remember, Origen is kind of presupposing all these things. He thinks they're uncontroversial, revealed to us in the Scriptures, and then he's got to use his speculative mind to figure out how they all hang together. So this is what he does. The world includes all manner of things for Origen. Let's make some really hyper-technical categories here. We got human beings, puppy dogs, angels, and demons, all right? Those are technical categories. Human beings, puppy dogs, angels, and demons. And the world is kind of, I'm going to get this out and then I'm going to talk. The world is kind of assembled in a great chain of being, in a hierarchy of sorts. Angels, of course, are at the top. Then us. Then puppies. And then demons. Origen thinks it's just kind of self-evident. He thinks it's just natural to realize that being a puppy is a little worse a life than being a human. Now, we might debate him. Puppies seem to live pretty good lives as far as I'm concerned. But for him, he thinks that a puppy is not quite as good a thing as it is to be a human. Likewise for demons, angels, that kind of a thing. He says it doesn't make any sense that we would be born into positions in life which seem to be unjust. Because we not only have distinctions, you know, some people are born as demons, some people come into the world as angels, some come into the world as human beings, but also among human beings we have different distinctions. Why is it that some people are born into circumstances which seem to promote their flourishing? And why is it that some people are born into circumstances which are very difficult? Origen thinks that in order to maintain the ideas that God is all-powerful, all-good, and just. That God is just, yeah, thank you, and that God is just, what you have to do is you have to basically say, well, it's their fault. He thinks you need to be able to say that wherever it is that you ended up, you deserved it. So the way that he does this is he says that there's a kind of first initial creation. We're all kind of up here, and we're disembodied minds, or what he calls rational natures. Okay? Our rational natures enjoy communion with God. That's kind of all we're up to up there. We don't, okay, so we're immaterial spirits. It's something you can think about it that way. We're just enjoying communion with God. And we enjoy communion with God until we basically get tired of communion with God. That's how the story goes. He describes our fall as we're satiated or we get bored. The example that I was taught is it's kind of like you have a world-class doctor. And the world-class doctor begins to take the world-class doctor's world-class skills for granted. And then decides, well, you know, I don't have to go and read those boring, old, dull medical journals for hours at a time. And so they cease to kind of work on being a world-class doctor. They take it for granted. And gradually over time, because they stop working at it, they cease to be a world-class doctor. The same thing kind of happens on a sort of huge scale. We all kind of get accustomed to enjoying communion with God, and then we kind of get tired of it. We cease to work at it, and so we give it up. And what happens when we give it up is we fall. And some of us fall a little more than others. He says these rational natures, these minds, cool. And when they cool, they become souls. It's really, really interesting. So some people fall and they become angels. Some people become human beings. Some people, actually, nobody becomes a puppy. and then some people fall and they become demons. The goal of human life is to work your way back to this. And that's where Jesus comes in. Jesus is the only rational nature that doesn't fall. Jesus is always up here. And Jesus himself is sent down here to kind of the middle of the scheme of things in order to teach and instruct and show the way back to perfect communion with God. The most controversial of, well, there are a lot of controversial beliefs. One of the most controversial beliefs that Origen had was he thought that eventually, at the end of time, all creatures would be reconciled to God. There was a fancy Greek word for this. Break it down into syllables. Apokatastasis. That's just the word for universal reconciliation. The story goes that, okay, so we're all in these different sorts, we have these different sorts of bodies, these different sorts of lives and existences. And in some sense, we deserve whatever state of affairs we find ourselves in, because our souls pre-exist us. They were in communion with God, and then they fell into these bodies. The apokatastasis means that eventually we're all going to make our way back. But how? You can kind of think about this like grades in a school. So for Origen, you kind of complete your life. And at the end of that life, you've either proceeded on to the next grade or you get held back. You kind of think about this in a kind of cosmic, on a cosmic scale. Origen had an understanding of successive world orders, or ages, eons, where human beings could be, their souls could transmigrate into a different material world at a different time and live a different existence. So this is what Chuck Robertson in the chapter was referring to as his potential belief about reincarnation. The fancy word for this is the transmigration of souls. What you should know about this is that the transmigration of souls was a philosophy that was circulating around the time of Origen. We know it primarily from other religions, particularly the religions of the East, such as Hinduism. But this was an idea that was kind of, it was just around in the water in Greek philosophy in general. Some of the Platonists believed in the transmigration of souls, some of the Pythagoreans and all this sort of thing. And so Origen is speculating, along with basically every other philosopher of his day, about whether or not this could be a Christian sort of thing. For him, it provided a solution for the fact that he really needed a picture where we all deserve whatever we got. But he ultimately thought that God had to get what God wanted, which was for everybody to be saved. The solution to that was that, well, you have potentially an infinite number of lives to get it right. Such that, at the end, at the last, he says, even the devil can be reconciled to God. The belief about the trans... Lots of people began to pick up on this particular part of his thought and to critique it. He was famously critiqued by Jerome for preaching the transmigration of souls. You have to be very careful about this. He definitely disqualifies some versions of the transmigration of souls. So if you're going to say Origen is wrong, you should really figure out what Origen actually said, so that you can say, well, that's wrong, instead of accusing him of something he didn't actually say. So what he definitely discounts is any sort of reincarnation in this world and in this age, okay? So it's not like you're born into a life right now and you're a doctor. And then after you die, he thinks, depending on whether you lived your life well or not, you can come back and you would end up in this life as a tree or an ant or something like that. He says that's definitely not the case, because there were Greek philosophers around who were teaching just that. They taught not only that you would be that your soul would transmigrate into a body within this world and this age, but also that human beings could become things like trees or puppy dogs. And he says that's definitely not the case. But a human being, he thinks, could be born in a different world, in a different time, as either a demon or as an angel or as a different sort of human being. And this could continue and continue and continue and continue until basically the whole world came to freely choose God. It's really a kind of beautiful picture. I mean, it is trippy, okay? It's very trippy. But in that way, the end is like the beginning. We started up here, and then we go through the experience of life, and then we come back to God. The idea being that once we have gone through the experience of fallen existence, once we've gone through all this rigmarole of the actual work of a life in this world, we will never get bored with God again. In part because we have potentially an infinite number of questions to ask God about the world and about everything that we had to go through. It's a move from innocence to experience. And like innocence and experience normally work in our world, through experience we would finally have the permanence and stability that we did not have in the beginning. So there are, be very interesting to talk about all manner of things about his theological system. I just want to briefly, before we have a time to chat, talk about the way in which Origen sets the agenda for four other things, okay? So this seems to us to be a very, I've been calling it trippy, that's probably the nice way to call it. It's a kooky way of thinking about the Christian life. However, we should remember that Origen is really very early. Origen is living in the 3rd century, before the Council of Nicaea, okay, whose creed we say in during the Eucharist. He's living in the middle of doctrinal disputes, okay? He doesn't have the benefit of any sort of solid understanding of what the Trinity is, or the way that sin works, or the way that free will works. He's having to make up this stuff on the fly. In doing so, he doesn't always get everything right from the perspective of the later Orthodox thinkers, okay? But increasingly we're realizing just how influential Origen was on all of those thinkers. And he sets the agenda, for one thing, on the doctrine of the Trinity, which is a very, very interesting doctrine of the Trinity, where he seems to say that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are all co-eternal, all divine, that sort of a thing. But he also seems to suggest that there's some sort of subordination between the persons. And from that, you get both the Arian controversy, those people who thought that the Son was not divine, but rather a creation of the Father, and of some folks called the Cappadocians, who included Basil of Caesarea, his brother Gregory of Nyssa, and their friend Gregory of Nazianzus. Both Nissen and Gregory of Nazianzus have very, very nice things to say about Origen. And Gregory of Nazianzus is, with Basil, is actually a compiler of a kind of edited collection of Origen's works. Great admirers of them, of Origen, and they are like they're the Orthodox's Orthodox. Okay, you can't get any more Orthodox than they are. That was the group of folks, the Cappadocians, who came up with the idea that, or they really solidified the idea, that the Son is of the same substance, homoousion, as the Father, of one being with the Father, as we sometimes say in the Creed. The second thing Origen set the agenda on was Scripture. You would think from all of this that Origen was primarily a philosopher and that he was letting his Neoplatonism kind of get away with him. But actually, he wrote incredible scriptural commentaries. He really just thought that his Platonic philosophy was a good way to understand what the scriptures had to tell us. One of his ideas is that there is a spiritual sense to scripture. You know, we modern people think we're the only ones to have ever noticed that there are contradictions in the Bible. That's completely false. We're the only ones to think that that is a huge, unbeatable problem, however. So Origen noticed contradictions in the Bible all the time. He said, you know, this doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense why God would do this. This seems to be unethical, unjust of God to do this. So he said, there must be a deeper sense here. I must just not be seeing it. There must be a spiritual sense to Scripture, a kind of depth to it. His scriptural commentaries in this regard are really, really quite extraordinary. The third thing that he set the agenda on was the spiritual life. Many of you are familiar with the kind of stages of the spiritual life. You kind of go through a purgative stage and then a contemplative stage and a unitive stage. Well, Origen was the first one to come up with that. It was inherited by Gregory of Nyssa, got inherited by the Pseudo-Denis, and then was inherited by the whole host of Christian mystics who we know and love, up to and including Teresa of Avila and John of the Cross. But he's the first one to do it. And finally, his understanding of the apokatastasis or eschatology. Eschatology meaning the study of the end. Now, the idea that everybody, including the devil, could be saved is not something that only Origen thought. We also think that, you know, those people I was calling the Orthodox as Orthodox, the early church fathers Gregory of Nyssa and Gregory of Nazianzus, both of them say basically the same thing, that in the end, God will get God's way and even the devil will be saved. This is, of course, a belief that was not shared by everybody in the early church and it has continued not to have been shared across the whole sweep of Christian history up till now. However, in the 20th century, as we begin to realize just how smart and clever Origen was, even if we don't agree with everything that he said, a lot of 20th century theologians began to reevaluate whether or not Origen could have been correct about the apokatastasis. What's really remarkable is that an early church father whose writings were condemned in the 6th century by an ecumenical council, I mean, quite an accomplishment, has a book published in the late 20th century. This is in the Classics of Western Spirituality series. It includes his Exhortation to Martyrdom, prayer, and then some other interesting stuff. The introduction to this book and the translation work was done by a man named Rowan Greer. Father Greer was one of Father Peter's professors at Yale Divinity School. He was a patristics professor. What's also interesting is that the foreword is written by one of, if not the most influential Roman Catholic theologian of the 20th century, Hans Urs von Balthasar. Really quite incredible that a guy who was condemned by an ecumenical council received that kind of attention now. And in part, especially for Balthasar paid attention to his belief about apokatastasis, or the idea that all may be saved. In any case, that's probably enough to get our discussion started. We had three questions. Yeah, exactly. We had three questions that Chuck had recommended to us. The first just had to do with all those, with what I was calling episcopal intrigue. Where have you seen that in the church? What do you think you do about it? And how have you experienced the difficulty of standing up for the truth and standing up for Jesus and being a part of what is really a messy human political organization, that is, the church? The second question was just about the apokatastasis, that Origen's most controversial belief is that even the devil may be saved. How does that strike you? Do you think that's persuasive? Is it beautiful to you or is it abhorrent? Rather odd to imagine a picture where the devil is dining at the wedding banquet with all of us. And then the other was about his version of reincarnation or the transmigration of souls. Continues to be rather controversial. What do you think about it? Do you find it convincing or not? So just break up into small groups for just a little while, about 5-10 minutes, and then we'll come back.
Okay. Why don't you do this? Why don't you organize it by question?
Great.
So, you know, sort of Carol Merrill behind curtain number one.
Yeah.
So if you get question one here, question two, and question three, and we'll make three groups. Why don't you do that?
Great, that's perfect. Okay, so if you want to talk about church politics and episcopal intrigue, right there. If you want to talk about apokatastasis, the devil being saved, right here. If you want to talk about reincarnation, the transmigration of souls, over there. Great.
Well, share what we've all been talking about. Try and have a larger discussion. Yeah. I'm been told to hush by the political intrigue group. So perhaps the best way to do this would be to hear from each of the groups. That way we have a chance to talk about each of the questions. Why don't we start with the reincarnation group, transmigration of souls. What did you all think? Yay, nay, trippiest thing you've ever heard?
Maybe yes, maybe no.
Maybe yes, maybe no.
That's probably great.
I'm the maybe yes. Uh-huh.
Everybody else is the,
well, I don't know.
No, we think even Lucifer might be a candidate for.
Oh.
I'm not even on the Navy side.
Okay, so this group said that there were some maybes, one definite yes, and then a couple maybe a little weaker than a maybe on the transmigration of souls. Did anybody else discuss that? I don't know what this this other group. Yeah, back there.
Wait for the
mic. Thanks.
We didn't understand. Was it soul or was it eternal? Was it physical? We really asked more about what he really meant.
Yeah. The soul for him is not eternal. It has a beginning, but it did pre-exist your current. It pre-exists your current existence, and so it basically the soul gets thrown into different bodies. Depending on the life you're in and how good you lived your last one, you could be born as quite the human being, or you could be born as a human being with a rather difficult life, or you could end up, worst of all, as a demon down there with the worst of the worst, with Lucifer.
But Justin, if our population continues to increase, how can we pre-exist? If our population continues to increase, how do you pre-exist?
Excellent question. It was a death that this pre-existence or whatever, this first creation was rather crowded, wouldn't it? Yeah. No, that's an excellent question. That's an excellent question. And it should be clear that Christian teaching does eventually abandon this particular belief. They come to think that the transmigration of souls is not the way to go, but that the rest of the system, the kind of idea that you're going through a journey where you learn stuff, you have experience, then you return, and you're in some way better off than you were before, that becomes a kind of consistent thing. Yeah.
So, the story of Adam and Eve, does that not have a founding in this philosophy?
This is how he would interpret the story of Adam and Eve. So he would interpret it allegorically rather than historically. Yeah. Interesting that you get that kind of interpretation not just in the 20th century. We think we're all so smart. He did it in the 3rd. So we're not that special.
Maybe there were less people but more trees then. The soil.
Yes. Yes, that's exactly right. No, totally. Oh my goodness. So what about apocatastasis? These people, can the devil be saved?
You spoke best.
Thank you. Well, I think our group, I think a mixture of us believe in it. I believe in it. I believe that everybody can be reconciled. I think there's a challenge is to have faith to trust in that.
Yeah. Yeah. That's beautifully put. Other thoughts on that from that group or elsewhere? It's beautiful put.
In your group discussion, did you agree that even the devil?
Well put. Beautifully said.
So
Since I'm holding the microphone, I just actually read something that from a class I took a long, long time ago, a Lenten class. A similar question, which was, can people who we feel are absolutely horrible, like demons, end up in heaven? And how do we feel about people like, at the time, Osama bin Laden was on people's minds.
Right.
Hitler, people talked about Hitler. You know, can these people end up in heaven? Well, how do you end up in heaven? Yeah. Well, through God's love.
Right.
Right. So some people were very fussed in this class that Osama bin Laden and Hitler and similar type people would be in heaven with them.
Yeah.
And the woman who was leading the discussion said, oh, do you think that God's love is limited in some way, not strong enough to redeem those people? That somehow their horror is bigger than God's love? Are you willing to say that? And they didn't have an answer. So
that's incredibly powerful. It's incredibly powerful. Thanks, Jill. What about Episcopal intrigue? Church politics, the truth and the messiness of things.
Tom left.
Robin first and then Bob can take the mic.
Our spokesperson left.
Oh.
But we
throw him out.
Just like Origen was thrown out.
We talked about three different kinds of things. One was a cousin of mine who was caught up in Episcopal politics when he was called to be the dean of a cathedral and built the cathedral up so much that the bishop got upset and fired him. And it just absolutely was the introduction to corporate politics in the church. I never thought it worked that way. And then we talked about Bishop Robinson and all of what happened around him and people leaving and people setting up in-home churches and that kind of thing. And then Tom was talking about a video that they had watched on Canterbury, which they just came back from, and about the fact that churches belong to the diocese, not to the congregation.
Brewers go through that right now.
Right.
Go, go, go.
I just said that we concluded it exists.
Yes. And we all ought to be comforted that it is not a new problem. Father Peter with a word about problems or a lack thereof.
So I love the different topics here, and I have a lot to say in all of them, but I'm going to take a pass. Just in the category of humor, on reincarnated souls or transmigrating souls. I started something in Cleveland called the Men's Spirituality Group, which met in a bar and met 7:30 in the morning, and Thelma, the waitress, would serve us breakfast. And this is a group that's still going on now 20 years later. And we were back there and we were studying the classics of Western Christianity, I mean, one after another. It was really an amazing group. And someone said, I have a Taoist friend who was a Taoist master. And we were like, yeah, let's bring him in. And so he came in and he was discussing Taoism at 7:45 in the morning in this dank bar, while the guy was squirting because of the cockroaches. And he said, yes, well, Peter, referring to me, was a Carmelite nun in his previous life. That's the only thing I can remember about all those years I spent with these men. Anyway, and I couldn't help it. I had to run out for a moment. And I went across the way and I took a picture of Brown Greer that I have up in my office, who is the theologian that Father Justin referred to, one of my teachers. And he's with his dog. His dog went to all classes, went to church, went everywhere with him, and a great love of my life. And I'm seeing Jennifer used to have us over to his house for dinner periodically. And he's died, and it's a great sadness to me, and it makes me want to cry that I didn't get to see him before he died. Anyway, on to the topic of dying. So sorry to switch so quickly. Next weekend, so next Sunday at 9:00, I hope you'll tell your friends, we're going to take a look at the Passion narrative, which is what we're going to be reading on Sunday of the Passion, Palm Sunday, which is proverbially known as Palm Sunday. We're going to take a look at that narrative and see the resistance that Jesus faced, because it's all right there in Thursday night and Friday morning for Jesus, and then Friday afternoon. So I hope you'll come, and we'll have a good go of that. Thanks to Father Justin for enlightening us and expanding our spectrum of minds. God bless you.